Nigeria, the Rotary Club, and the New World Order. So essentially, I'll start by introducing myself. I've done an introduction. So I started business at age 14. I studied engineering at Muhammad Bello University. And I have my interest in media, in publishing, and agriculture. I've been exposed to government and public service through my involvement in the committee for developing a blueprint. Because see, you know, Nigeria has a huge out-of-school population of children. And so most of them are out of school because they prefer to go into the Islamic education as against the Western education. So the federal government decided to merge both education together to be able to make it attractive for them to go from being on the street into the classroom. So I was part of the committee that built the blueprint that the federal government used for that. And then of course, at the level of the constitution, in 2014, the federal government also wanted to afford Nigerians the opportunity to discuss how we wanted to coexist and see how we can modify the constitution. So I nominated the president to be on that committee. Basically, I have a foundation that helps to take these children to our school. So I took 24 of them and we've been taking care of their well-being from what we do. So I'm here to talk to you about the world. And the question is, where's the world going? You know, when you look at the world generally, you have, in my mind, I believe that you're going to have some major disruptions going forward. But I'm here, I'll be talking to you about some of them. One of it is the issue of food security. So in the coming years, food security will continue to be a big challenge. And it's going to be a challenge coupled with the fact that transporting food from one point to the other may be a huge one, and then response to famine in countries that have issues of food supply. So we need to begin to think about the disruption of food security will bring for us. And then of course the issue of health pandemic. We all know the outbreak of SARS, the outbreak of Ebola in Africa, and the way the world responds to it. Now when you have the health pandemic, the challenge you have is number one, how do you manage information? Because if you don't manage information properly, it leads to chaos. And when it leads to chaos, it brings about a disruption to peace and security. The next challenge you will have is, how do you contain a pandemic? How do you have fast response to provide cure for it? And then in areas that are affected, the next challenge is the issue of food. Because people will not naturally want to take food to certain places. And of course, the economy. So it's going to be a major thing that's going to be affecting the economy. And then the next disruption is technology. So technology brings a lot of good things, and it's going to come with a lot of challenges too. So the question is, how are we responding to those challenges? So an example of such a challenge is when, I mean, technology advancement disruption is when you think about Uber. So you know, with the press of a button, you have a taxi right in front of you. But I think what Uber is going to try to do going forward, as we know, is to have taxis without human the internet. So today, you know, Uber has created a lot of small business owners, proud business owners, that have their taxis and they are able to pick you up once you just connect with them. So the question is, when Uber now begins to do Uber without, I mean, taxis without driver, what happens to them? They will lose their jobs. So that would be the downside of technology, and we need to begin to, think of how we're going to deal with such a job loss. As you can see, the protest in Europe against Uber, amongst a whole lot of other things, are just signals that technology will also bring some destabilization if we don't think about it. Then, of course, the huge challenge of global threats. The issue of global threats, when you look at ISIS, when you look at the Libya challenge, when you look at Boko Haram, when you look at the current attack in Paris last week, as it gets to me. This is going to continue to be a huge challenge for the world, and it's extremely important that we look at it. And then of course population will continue to grow in population. So how are we going to deal with this population and growth? Is population going to be a blessing or is it going to be a curse? Now when you have population, the next thing is the issues of poverty, the issue of employment. Now what are the areas that can continue to make people to be employable? And then of course population comes with the challenge of peace and security that will finally come with the issues of the refugee crisis we are having in Europe. So These are major disruptions that I think we need to begin to think about in the world. Because when you look at the Rotary is trying, I believe one of the objectives of Rotary, of Rotary, is to try and see how you can have a world order where there's peace and security, where things flourish. So it's also extremely important that you begin to look at all these disruptions and what mitigating factors you're going to put, you know, to be able to check. So when you look at of this disruption, I want to zero in on three of it, looking at the challenge to the U.S. You know, when you're talking about the challenge of food security. Now, I think one major challenge that the U.S. has and will continue to have going forward is the issue of sustainability. So you have a sustainable and traceable source of raw material. You have a huge population, actually about 318 million people, and of course, with people, there's the need for food for people to eat. So how do you ensure that you have the supply of raw materials? And how do you ensure that those raw materials are traceable? Because if you're not able to trace it, the source of your food can be a means of even terrorism, if you don't know where it's coming from. The source of your food can be, you may not want your food to come from maybe processes that go in variance with your beliefs. So it's important that we are able to do that and then to sustain that. Now, from the angle of the global threat, which is a huge threat for the US, I read in the news this week about the threat from the ISIS people wanting to
Washington
and neighboring states. Now, the question is, what is African's role in this threat? So what is Africa contributing to this threat? Then how can you, we need to look at that challenge. Then when you're looking at the economy, when you look at the Western world, there's this saturation of the economy, they develop the opportunity for profit because, you know, we have a lot of competition. So there's a need for new markets, and that market is, you're talking about the emerging market, and that's where the African market is key for you to be able to stay profitable. So you need to begin to look at that. So the question is, do you need new markets? Now, what type of market do you want? And when you're looking about the African market, you need to also look at it in retrospect to what is the Chinese doing. The Chinese, the Westerners have had a head start when it comes to the African market. But in recent years, China has really, you know, railed in a lot into the African market. So the question is, what are you doing about it? So now let me come to the issue of Nigeria. So Nigeria, a beautiful country called Nigeria. Nigeria is populated with about 180 million people. We are a large market because of that population that we produce. And then we have a huge expanse of arable land. We have large mineral deposits, oil deposits. We have large gas deposits. And these are huge resources. We have that we can claim to be a stable democracy now. So since 1999, we've had successive transition of governance without any major issues. We have over $250 million movie industry that is still thriving. Nollywood, I think, is next to Bollywood. We have a huge music industry, and these are great opportunities. We're the largest economy in Africa at the moment, and then we're the sixth largest in the world. So these are great opportunities so that we can look at. Now, when I look at it, what is Rotary doing in the world? What I can see is that Rotary is trying to promote peace and security. We are trying to fight the disease. We are trying to provide clean water, save mother and children, supporting education. Well, actually, we tell you all this. I believe you all know what you're doing. But the challenge is how much of this is really going on in Africa, and specifically, how much of this is happening in Nigeria. So then, what can be done to improve on what is happening? One major plus for the Rotary institution in Africa, in Nigeria precisely, is the eradication of polio. I think Rotary has partnered with other governors and other NGOs to fight Rotary and polio. And the good news is, for example, in Nigeria, I think polio has been finally eradicated. All thanks to the efforts of people like you. So that's a very good cross. So I couldn't find statistics or reports on what you are doing with regards to promoting peace, or what you are doing with regards to promoting education, or what you are doing with regards to promoting the local economy. But these are great areas that Rotary. Now, the question for me is, how can Rotary and the Nigerian business collaborate so that we can have a better world? So, you see, with your population standing at 318 million, we need to, and if you look at the next 10 years, what are we going to do now? By way of your population, you're going to have an exponential growth. And if you, with that, still this issue that I'm talking about, the issue of source of raw material and semi-processed raw material. And Africa is a wonderful place that you can partner and link so that you can have a sustainable way of getting these things. We can always produce things like peanut, cashew, maize, sorghum. So, I hear some companies like Kaya in Minneapolis are doing a whole lot and they are trying to link up with the African agricultural setting to develop capacity for such by way of training, by way of funding and access to market. So I think these are areas that Rotary can look at how to meet the effort. And then again, you see, nations are getting smaller. Nations are getting borderless. And that is why if you look at it today, if you look at the situation we have in the world today, there's a war going on, but it's not a war between nations. It's actually a war between a group of people that pan across and have a network across the nation, fighting the whole world. So it's not about nation to nation any longer. We're coming borders. Now, from a positive point of view, how do we take advantage of that? It's about opening the market, like I keep saying. It's about access to input, access to raw material, and all those things. So, and then when you say that we are borderless, the next question you need to ask is, why do you have a situation where you have African supply? So you have countries now that are doing business in Africa, but you have a situation where your supply from your factory is still coming from America. So which means you produce in America, and then you have to ship it all the way down to Africa. So is this a sustainable model? Does it allow for competition? Does this make you competitive? Because at the end of the day, these are part of the key reasons why China has that major role. So I think American companies need to begin to look at locating their factories, the source of raw materials, and to market. So if you have an African, population that is a market, it just makes sense that you should be able to locate a factory there so that you can produce, you can create job opportunities around that area, and yet you can be able to get to market at a competitive price. And some companies are doing it. Dangote in Nigeria, Dangote is a multinational company now. They are in about 14 African countries, and they are not producing, it's headquarters in Nigeria, but they don't have one factory. So what they did is they have factories in each of the places that they need to, and it's a model that works. There's this company too in France, Nutrisense, that does plumpy nuts. They also do the same thing. They locate their factories. So I think it's one thing that we need to be looking at. So we have the land. We have the manpower. But the bad news is when you look at the manpower, you're talking about a huge unemployment of the youth. And this is, when you link it up, this is a very veritable market or breeding ground for this terrorism. It's a big issue. So the way Rotary can play a middle role between the American companies and Africa, and Nigeria specifically, is to be able to see how you can bring this youth into employment, how you can bring this youth into skills acquisition. This is extremely important because if those issues are not sorted out, if you're trying to solve the issue of terrorism, you can't just solve it by just throwing bombs and throwing drones. While you're trying to do that to curtail the excesses, you need to look at the root cause. You need to look at where the funding is coming from. You need to look at where the people are coming from. The instability in Libya has opened up that area. Arms and weapons and training is linking up to Nigeria. That's where, after Libya failed, is when we saw the rise of Boko Haram. So it's a key issue. Then when you look at the health pandemic response, the way we can collaborate, you see, when Ebola hit, America responded with about $380 million. Now this money was used to build camps that were meant to be taken to Libya, to have into Liberia to contain Ebola. But the bad news is, before these things got to Liberia, Ebola had been contained. So the question now is, you're having 380 million of taxpayers' money that was practically just wasted. So the response was not quick. Now, but while that was ongoing, when I went in Nigeria took it upon itself, and we were able to curtail Ebola, we were able to treat Ebola. So what I'm trying to say is that when you are trying to match support for such pandemic responses, I think it's important that the Western world and America begins to look at how to support research, how to support Africans to solve African problems, rather than to try to bring funding and bring equipment or bring things that need not tally with what we really want. So a way that Rotary can provide a mediating ground is to ensure that linkages that can support research that can lead commercialization. So that way we can help the response to that. And then of course, the issue of the outdoor scheme. You see, outdoor scheme is a model, as we know, for agriculture that can put people out of the street into the jobs. So you have a model of local farmers, and then you bring them together, you give them access to capacity, access to training, access to farm inputs, and then of course you buy from them, and then you process it, and then you process it, and then you export it. So things, that kind of a scheme is a key area that Rotary can partner with local partners to be able to achieve. And of course, the issue of loan to rural women, I saw you doing some of it, I saw some of it when I did some research on what you're doing. And of course, like I emphasized, the need to support research. And then the issue of low interest. You can give grants to startup companies. You can also give low interest rate to existing companies for expansion. Now you see, where I would want to take my discourse to is how to link the NGO to business to the social good. So if you, beyond maybe your effort on polio or your effort at amassing resources together, you can also support companies that can grow up, companies that have CSR as part of the key component of what they do. So by supporting such companies, those companies can grow in capacity. And once they've committed that a certain percentage of what they have will go into CSR, you can see that you can also have a pool of funds in the NGO community to continue to do the good work that is happening. Now when you talk of the challenges like this, the challenges of doing business in Nigeria, while I've talked to you about Nigeria and how good Nigeria is, and there are certain challenges of doing business in Nigeria, the challenge of fraud, the challenge of security, the challenge of ease of doing business, the challenge of infrastructure, I know the challenge of slow cost systems. Now how do you go around this? One of the key areas of going around this is to work with local partners that have verifiable records, track records, that understand the terrain. That is one key area. And when you're talking about local partners, you see, how do you get to know that? There are certain systems that sieve out the kind of people you should do business with. For example, President Obama selected some young African leaders and invested taxpayers' money in their training. So I was a beneficiary of it. I was in Northwestern University in Illinois for about 3 months in Emerson. Massive training, massive opportunity for capacity building and things like that. So that's a huge investment of taxpayers' money. But afterwards, what next? What next is collaborations of this nature that can ensure that we can now do business together, we can do trade, that can bring foreign direct investment across board, and then everybody can be good for it. So, and then of course you can use technology to mitigate these challenges, and of course the issue of when the next challenge is when you are trying to put money into Africa, you are worried about the security of your finances. So one way to go is to work with local banks in Nigeria that can provide guarantee for your finances if you are going to put money into Nigeria. So regardless of this mitigating factor, Nigeria is such a huge market that you cannot ignore. So what you need to do is to see how you can be an investor working with local partners that can help you to bring the benefit and value that Nigeria has to offer. So basically, if you look at, I want to give you some little examples of some success stories of companies doing business and also doing CSR. So you have Dangote Industry. Aliko Dangote is the richest man in Africa. He's worth about $16.7 billion. He's present in 14 African countries. He has the largest manufacturer of sacks in the world. Now he has a CSR that is linked to his company, and he has invested over $100 billion in CSR. Now, as Dangote grows in resources, that is the way the money is available for CSR also grows. he's putting it into Africa. Then MCN Nigeria.